In this day and age, we really need to understand ourselves. We need to understand ourselves through our history, our personal history, and our ancestors' history. And there's no better way of doing that than to put on their clothes, than to crawl into their skin. I think this interview with Boone Morrison is an excellent example of that very thing. Enjoy.
You know, back in 75, the road crew, me and about 30 boys, came through here. Captain Martin had his station down the way, and we're cutting away on up into Kentucky, over the gap there. We're looking for the easy way, following Indian trail, game trail, whatever. Chopping away the brush and throwing logs down on streams just to make a way for horses. Now our sponsor, this man Henderson, he's following along behind. He's got wagons with supplies and more helpers and all that kind. So we're blazing this road. And we're pushing ahead, maybe 2 weeks ahead of him, I guess it was. And he shows up here at Martin's to discover that there's no road. There's a trail, and he can't get over the trail. So he pauses here. While he's paused here, the Cherokee hit us. We have this big fight. They hit us at dawn, as usual. A couple of men are killed. Captain Twitty's shot through the hips, both sides. Well, we can't move him. He's going to die if we move him. He tells us to leave him. We ain't going to do that. So we decide to build him a shelter. We called it Fort Twitty. Laid him up in there for a week, got him better, put him on a horse litter, took him on up the rest of the way. Well, Daniel, he had to write a letter back to Henderson telling him, send aid, come quickly. And he tells him about this Indian fight. He tells him not to worry, though, because we saved the baggage. It was quite a day. We kept on going, made our way up to the site of this new town, Boonesboro, and went to work. Henderson come along a couple of weeks later with his pack horses, couldn't get the wagons up, and that's where we started it. I'm Boone Morrison. I live in Hawaiian Islands right now, born and raised in California. I get that first name because I'm a four times great-grandson of Daniel Boone, descended from his youngest son, Nathan. And Nathan's daughter, Sarah, marries, travels out to California in 1846, establishing our family there. I've always known about that heritage and always very much enjoyed history. Read about it forever. For some reason, unknown to me, partly because I went out to Hawaii when I was young, I never clicked with historic reenacting till about 10 years ago. And as they say, I fell off the back of a turnip truck into the middle of this mess. It has absolutely gotten my attention. I travel here to Martin Station every year for the event. Have done so for, this is my eighth time. Of all the places that I've now gone and all the events I've been to, I consider this to be the premier. This is as close to how it was as you're going to get. The reenactors who come here are the cream, the best. The efforts at this authenticity make this into a time machine. It's a time machine. You lose contact with the 21st century. And I get frightened by a cell phone, for example. It doesn't make sense to me when I'm in this mindset. As far as a persona, I have trouble portraying my grandfather, Daniel. Even though it seems like an obvious choice, it just seems presumptuous to me. So I've decided to be Mr. Boone. He's a family member. He's been around for all of the great adventures that folks could relate to in terms of talking about it. He could tell stories on his brother. Maybe it's his brother, maybe it's his uncle, I don't know. Why do I do it? It's a difficult question. Top of the list, it's an incredible amount of fun. That's simple enough. It gives me a chance to take a ride on the time machine, to participate in things that help me kind of understand what all these stories must have been like, what it was like to live in these places. You spend days in an environment like this and you kind of get the picture. You go out in the woods on a trek or on a hunt or something and you begin to get some of that impression. And you begin to realize what those folks knew. The body of knowledge that was common in these folks was just incredible if you look at it. And I find that you get so far into it that when the event is over, dressing in what we call civilian clothes, modern clothing, feels strange. That's when you know you've been on the other side. There's something fundamental about this life and this knowledge. It's so basic unto us. A small example, when we make camp in some place other than a set camp like this, one of the first things that one does is to figure out where the fire is going to be. That notion of fire being at the center. As an architect, which is my profession, one of the early things we do is to determine where is the fire center in the home. That habit of locating that center point, that locus in a given life space, a physical space, is still with us. We don't realize where it came from. We were talking with some of the children today about some of the phrases that have stayed with us that we don't even know where they came from anymore. A buck. It's worth a buck. Where's that come from? Well, it comes from the $1 value of the skin of a buck deer. Buckskin. People use it all the time today with no knowledge of where it came from. So there's this whole underlying set of values and understandings that we live with and don't even know where it came from. And I think somehow getting back to that, getting back to those essential basic things, is good for our spirits. This is for your spirit. This isn't for your mind. For a person who has an interest in history to begin with, and then transcends that into living history, actually participating in it. Maybe you saw a movie like Last of the Mohicans and thought, wouldn't it be cool to do that, to be in that movie? That's what we're doing here. And if there's an interest on your part, it's pretty easy. Come to a couple of events, watch what's going on. Everybody who is doing this is very enthusiastic about what they're doing. We love to talk to people about it. We love to answer questions, and we love to share, just like I'm sharing, why you do this. Pick up some simple duds, some gear. There are certain places, here at Martin's, for example, they actually have some clothing that you can borrow for the day so you don't feel so silly wearing your tennis shoes and so on. If you don't have a good pair of moccasins, they went barefoot a lot in the 18th century, so don't worry about that part. It can be done. Everybody will take you in hand. We'll keep you from falling in the fire and burning your toes and things like that. And it just might click. The only danger is if it clicks, you're in for it. It gets a hold of you. And then you go, for me, I managed to make it to the mainland here a few times a year. As it gets closer to the date, it's all I can think about. It becomes this overriding desire to go do that again. And for the premier events, Martin's being one, I wait all year to get here. It's that important. And I'm gathering my gear and fixing new stuff and learning things and studying up and all these different things to get ready to be here. And this is kind of the payoff, these weekends. And I keep coming earlier and earlier just to extend the experience. I think it was 4 years ago here at Martin's. I was walking down the trail from the hunter's camp here down toward the park, the main part of the park where the fort is, at dawn. And it was just the most beautiful scene, just in that sense, never mind the history part. The fort and the outlying cabins are perfect replicas. And if you blink, you're there. And I was debating taking a picture, and something just said, don't bother. And I stopped at the gate leading into the upper yard and just stood there for a minute. And this little child came running out of one of the cabins and got something from out by the fire and went back in again. I just got chills. It was just the most amazing, simple little moment in a life. Smoke coming out of the chimney and the whole deal. I just sat there and laughed for a minute. It was just so great. Nothing that important, but a very meaningful time. In point of fact, they happen all the time. The list is endless. I'm sure every one of us has got a huge list. That's the one that came to mind when you asked.